draft ordinance.
All right, so we were going through basically the way in which the information comes out after some significant use of force. And the same basic principles happen where we arrive on scene with our supervisor, our PIO supervisor that's on the call all the time. And then we will also now, in addition to that, this is a new procedure, we're going to have command staff show up at the scene as well, again, to ensure the accuracy and timeliness of that information. Now, 24, 48 hours after the incident, now we are going to publish a press release right away as opposed to waiting for the chief's briefing for that. And that's in an effort to get that information out again. Oh, sorry. 24 to 48 hours right after the incident. Up until this point, we have been giving out the information after the chief's briefing, which is generally 72 hours, three to four days. But now we're going to get that out right away so that there's some information that we can give out as it happens. Again, with the basic premise that in the past the information was given out based on the interest in the incident, and now we want to set up a time frame that's expected every single time so that you know you're going to get information at these certain windows. Following the chief's briefing, we will give out the officers' names, which is what we've done before, as long as there is no threat of safety to the officer or anything like that. And then, of course, in that update, we'll give some new details at that point as well after the chief's briefing. So one of the new additions to the procedure will be, following that briefing about 2 weeks later, we're going to do a community update. And again, this is going to be a more detailed outline of the incident and the information that we have so far. Again, as we get more information, as interviews are witnessed, as evidence is uncovered, we're able to reveal more about what's going on, and we want to provide another window into what's happening, and that'll happen at that two-week mark, and it's going to come in the form of possibly a press conference, press release, or a video release that we will upload to our YouTube page, again, for the public to be able to see in its entirety, and, of course, allowing the press to have an option to ask questions at that point as well.
That's a video briefing, so it would be a briefing, a presentation of the evidence and what we understand in context that would be recorded by the department and then released to the public.
And then from that point on through the adjudication, we will release information as it becomes available as opposed to waiting for the adjudication at the end of it, as long as it doesn't compromise the integrity of the investigation. And then to culminate all of it, we understand that sometimes it's difficult to get the information, to get the different press releases, to get the adjudicated summary, to get all the things that come out as a use of force unrolls. So we're going to be creating a specific web page on LAPD Online where it will be dedicated to use of force, where you can click on the case, get all of the information in one spot as opposed to going to different spots. So we'll link all that resource information. And of course, it will provide all of our policies and procedures when it comes to use of force. So basically, one-stop shopping for everything that you would need to know about a case, again, to increase that level of transparency.
I have one question. How can you get agencies that we don't control, like the coroner's office, mm-hmm. and people like that? Because what happens is people transfer their missteps or whatever their own problems are, to us. You see that? You see it every time here. You see it here. You see it from the lady whose responsibility was to notify family members. You get it. How can we get them to get it? There's only so much we can do.
I'll take that question. I think there are a few things that we're going to try to do, which is actually work with them beforehand. And Mr. Rubenstein has been very good at reaching out to public information officers in all agencies, whether it's school police or coroner's office, etc. The key fact is going to be FID, Force Investigative Division, at the incident, making sure that they know we need the name, we need the autopsy and that. And then in addition, now that the family liaison unit is there, they are also another connection to those entities to make sure that they're getting, that they're releasing information or even providing information.
So we can follow up. So we can follow, so if it's 3 hours or 6 hours, maybe instead of waiting 5 or 6 days, we can start hammering them and say, look.
And we also, and through that process, we learned to understand what their work requires. So for example, the coroner may not have been able to locate someone, or oftentimes a hospital is responsible for notifying the coroner, et cetera, so we can follow up and ask them to make sure they get that notification. Or we talk to the coroner and learn that they haven't been notified and can rectify that situation. So there are a variety of things in place now that would help encourage that so that we can then determine whether, well, whether they're going to release it publicly, because of course the coroner releases the autopsy at the stage where they're completed, but also we can release the information once that's been done as well.
Just so I can understand. I know in the past my frustration with once we go on TV, maybe the So once we do go off, you'll get the information that if the information is usually scripted, it feels like we lack compassion or empathy for the whatever the use of force or officer involved shooting for the person that got hurt. And it doesn't feel good. It doesn't feel right. Have we figured out how we should make a presentation, give out information that's not so scripted and has some compassion, or at least the first one? Because once that first one that comes out, that's when I get the text that say, didn't you see how we presented? I've only seen one where a deputy chief was very, you know, he did a good job in presenting the information that he could, but I think what was more important is he had compassion and empathy for the family whose family member was just hurt.
Certainly. Not being a police officer, but worked with police officers in presentations at trial or other things, one thing I found is oftentimes in an effort to be objective, they tend sometimes to not want to show how they're truly feeling or that emotion. Also, you'll see in our press releases that we tend to use very generic language in an effort to be objective. Sometimes that works, sometimes it does not. I think it's important that now, with the levels of review and having outside input, we can provide better guidance on how to accurately put the information out, but also do so in a way that recognizes the human aspects of, for obviously, the person who and the family that understandably would be suffering, and also the danger that the officer experienced at the time as well.
So, I'm sorry. That was the other side of it too, in that our police officers that are involved, they always get updates of what's, and I don't know where that falls in here, what's happening with the process that he just got involved.
To make sure that they are
informed. They are informed, yeah.
But
I think that's a totally different.
Yes. And that's something we're working on within a separate track to make sure that the officers are informed of the process, because oftentimes they're not, simply because of their time on the job or just never haven't been exposed to the process. So we are working on a protocol for that. I know we've talked about that in the context of other services that they're providing.
And we're trying to create a situation where it's fair for everybody to get this information. We understand that it needs to come out quicker, because in the absence of that vacuum there, you're going to have all kinds of different things coming out. So for both sides, for the officers and for the public, we want to get that information.
So just at the risk of belaboring a conversation, when I know that moving back to additional agenda items is important, I do want to say, what you just presented, it's not written here, is it?
No, we have not. We had some discussions about this. We wanted to present it
So that's fine. Yeah. The thing that I want to raise is, as it relates to information inconsistency, my concern has been information about the individual, often the deceased individual, that is released rather rapidly that is sometimes either incorrect or that tends to portray them in a very narrow and often negative light. And I don't know, and I may have missed it, but I do believe that moving forward, that is something that is incredibly important to address. And that is often happening, you know, it's not just the timing of information, it's actually the substance through which there's a both perception and, in my experience, in a number of cases, a reality that we get the first crack at the mic, and when we use it to, present a laundry list of accusations or information or things that we either think we know or suspect about a party, that bell is hard to unring, and that does tremendous violence in connection with and so I don't know that I need a response. I'm just telling you what I think we need to be cautious about. And just because in the interest of time, not wanting to go back and forth around it, I mean, if you disagree, then certainly
I disagree.
Let me address this part. Thank you. So the main thrust of this is that we're putting higher ranking individuals who have more latitude about what they say at the scene to do the initial press conference. And that's why either Mr. Rubenstein or one of his command officers will be there and will control what goes out, and with an eye towards making it broader, more compassionate, and more informative. And, you know, it's hard to do things at 2 or 3 in the morning with first level supervisors who may or may not be good in front of the camera. And this adds a much deeper layer.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that.
Any other questions? Do we have any public comment on that?
2B, we have 11 comment cards. The first 4, Michael Novick, Wayne from Encino, Pete White, and Eddie H.
I think it's evident that if you spend half as much time trying to control the police department as you do trying to control the narrative in the public, you wouldn't have to spend so much time trying to control the narrative in the public. Back to the original presentation and this as well, since President Trump was elected, I've heard that 1984 is now the best-selling book in the United States, and I think that George Orwell had a role in writing your training. The very first slide you showed talked about their efforts at teaching de-escalation, and their use of de-escalation said less lethal weapons, which are then illustrated in the video. The guy jumped out with a beanbag shotgun. The idea that using less lethal doesn't mean it's not lethal. Using tasers and beanbag shotguns and rubber bullets and tear gas is not my idea of de-escalation. And if it's your idea of de-escalation, that's a big problem. I'll just repeat a couple of things I said before when you originally had this report. The simulators were developed by the military to get GIs to fire their weapons. And so the idea that you're using the simulators to teach people to be more judicious in firing the weapons is highly unlikely, as shown by the fact that you fire a lot of weapons and kill a lot of people. And second point I would make is that the whole thing about constitutional policing, we've seen what the Constitution results in, President Trump. If you're talking about fair and unbiased policing, but you're enforcing laws that criminalize poverty and homelessness, then you can very fairly and without bias arrest all the poor people, but the real criminals are getting away scot-free.
Mr. President, if I may, Captain Davalos has a presentation also on the side before you entertain public comment.
Sorry.
Did you already do it? He's good? Okay. I apologize. I was out of the room.
So this is a verbal follow-up to my last presentation on December 6th. It has to do with the status of vacancies within training division, police train education, and the area training coordinators throughout the geographic divisions.
Yeah.
Training division currently has three vacancies. One is for a supervisor and two officers. Police train education has one vacancy. That is for a supervisor. And for the area training coordinators and the assistant area training coordinator, those positions have been filled.
Great.
Great,
thank you. All right.
Can we continue?
Wayne
Spindler.
Yes.
Okay, I'm just having a nice pop-up show there, so I didn't want to interrupt. So, I started off with this presentation with bullet points. Bad idea. bullet points, I mean, you know, come on, man. I mean, you know, it can't be that crazy. So, you say that the, I went to the Superior Courthouse courtesy of your council president, and you jackasses when you arrested me, so I kind of know something that you may want to know. Turns out, the Superior Court knew Wakisha Wilson and what happened to her, and she was taken off the docket prior to the appearance. So they must have known, because I looked for her name on the list, and it wasn't there.
There you go.
See, that's because, why do I look into shit like this? Why do I find out about it? It's because you fuck with me, that's why. See, you fuck with me. So I have to learn about what you do. I have to learn about what you do. 88,000 pages on a thumb drive, people. Fuck is a problem. The Superior Court had her off the docket. She was not on the appearance list. Because there's a list they give you at 8:30 in the morning when you appear at the criminal courts building. Right. You check to see if you're on the list.
Right.
And you can recognize her name. There's nobody with this name. I looked for this very unusual name. I didn't see it. So how did that happen?
Wow.
Because coroner contacted them to the DA, and the DA contacted them and knew she had been in death custody. She wasn't going to go to court. They knew she wasn't going to go to court, or she would have been on the goddamn list unless you dropped the charges. But if you had dropped the charges, she would have been released with no bond and not held over for arraignment. Jackasses.
Hell fucking yeah, jackass.
So answer that, jackass. Answer why that happened. I'm waiting. Puppet show, baby.
White, LA Community Action Network. So we sat here and listened to the police say reality-based training 10, 20, 30 times, and we didn't realize that how disrespectful it was to hear y'all talking about a reality-based training that was parallel to our experience.
Right.
We understand the intention of your training is to train us to submit our bodies, our rights, our humanity, and simply accept state violence. But we will not rest, we will resist.
Yes.
We looked at those scenarios, and I almost hopped up and ran up and just kicked the chair over when you talked about talking someone down off the ledge, and I thought about Carlos Ocaño, where SWAT was called, and not Smart.
Yeah.
Smart could have walked around the corner from Central Division, SWAT was called and shot him when he was coming down with a beanbag, and he fell to his death. And so you show us these scenarios, and we have real life examples of people dying from the de-escalation. I was reminded of Stephen Eugene Washington. You remember him, Beck? Young African-American autistic man walking in K-Town. The police said they heard a loud noise, a bang. They did a U-turn. They killed him from the passenger seat of their car. They never got out. And you talk about de-escalation. We talk about Brother Africa.
Right.
We talk about Brother Africa and Francis Martinez, who is still patrolling the streets, who shot him down like a dog, and you're talking about de-escalation. We talk about Wakisha Wilson, who you can't even say her name.
Right.
We're here today because you can't say her name. And you talk about de-escalation. We talk about Tud Hayes, who in this room, in front of you, was dragged out like a fucking dog. Like a dog, when you talk about de-escalation and reality-based training. Your universe is parallel to ours, but we will not rest. We will resist.
Idiots, Los Angeles Community Action Network. There's a lot of things I want to say, and I really want to pivot after what Wayne Spingler said. Because it wasn't a mystery to us. We knew all along it was a cover-up of white people, but Keith's death. Like there's been a cover-up in so many other deaths. So when you present to us things about use of force, in de-escalation, we know in our community that it's a fallacy. I was in a meeting with two Inspector Busamani a couple years ago at the Newton Division. The chief of force was in that meeting as well, and I questioned him on how do you dole out uses of force. And something very interesting that he told me, he said both subjectively and objectively. Now, if we put that in a historical context, we know that uses of force have been used on us for over 400 years in this country.
Right.
Subjective only to the skin and pigmentation that we have. So we understand when bias policing and profiling goes forth, who that is being directed towards. So when you talk about de-escalation, there's no such thing when it comes to our community.
Right.
For I often say that the same training that police officers who occupy our communities is the exact same training of the officers who police Beverly Hills and Greenwood. But you don't have the incidents of abuses of force. You don't have the assassinations. You don't have the murders. You don't even have the stop and frisking going on in those communities. So you ought to tell us today that there is no crime in those communities as well. We understand today that we are under attack. And we're saying that no more. Once again, for I'm no ways tired. We're no ways tired. And we're not going to bow down, cower down, or be emasculated. But we're going to show up, and we're going to say, speaking truth to power, that your power is insignificant. For truly is a power, for you're operating from a deficit position. For anyone that does not understand that the heartfelt viewpoints of individuals coming to this committee week after week after week after week after week after week after week. It's not because we like you guys. It's because it's serious. We have a mother here that came to court. No one told her that her daughter was dead. How indignant, how disrespectful, how inhumane is that? But you want us to respect you.
Right.
That makes no sense. You haven't garnered any respect by doing
this
thing to do. We're sick of it. We're tired of it. And we say no more. Say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
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 Thank you. The next four speakers: Karen Hilton, Paula Miner, Robert Christo, and Mariela Saba.
After your presentation about training, made me very, very sad. This is a sad day anyhow. But what made me sad is that when we sit here and we hear you discuss things like officer-involved shooting, racial profiling, biased policing, police abuse, citizen complaints, often training is suggested as a possible solution, a possible panacea. But when we see presentations on training, like the examples that were given today, and we consider all the advancements in technology and video and training that exist, especially in Los Angeles, and this is what you present. It is so sad. It is so, so sad. It lets us know that it's a sham. It lets us know that it means nothing. And it also lets us know that it probably means very little to the officers who are subjected to that. You know, you can't expect that their emotional response to that is vastly different from the public. They know what's going on in the world. Just as we have our view, they have their view. And that training does not represent either view. Those of us who've had any training, and some of us have had training, understand that the best training is the attitude of the organization that you work for. That tells you how to work, okay? We all know that. When you come on the job, what everybody does is what you do. The other things are the expectations of your superiors, okay? How the superiors treat people, how the superiors discipline people, what happens when you make, quote, quote, a mistake, what happens when you, you know, shoot someone out of policy. The attitude of your superior trains you. And most of all, the behavior allowed on the job. Yeah. So the training, there is something wrong with it. It's not going to work. We need to say her name again. Every person who comes up needs to say her name. Say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
Say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
Say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
Seeing that first training video, I just couldn't remain silent. And I have to ask, in what reality does a man going through a recycle or trash bin warrant a police stop?
Exactly. To begin with.
Whether it's a beanbag gun or whatever, I was horrified. And sadly, I'm afraid I know what the answer is. And I think the rest of us do too. We see it around us all the time, which is the criminalization of homelessness and poverty. And then to find out that the focus of the debriefing and the discussion and the evaluation was the de-escalation tactics. And I would argue instead that the real lesson would be unpacking what the underlying assumptions are that allow the police department to create a scenario like that in the first place. And then just horrified again to see that they were evaluating, debriefing, and de-escalating a situation that the police had escalated and created. I'm leaving here today not knowing something I probably didn't know before, but just even more committed and confirmed to wanting to see these things at their very root, just change. And I heard somebody earlier saying that for training, seeing the movie The 13th would be a great idea, and I second that wholeheartedly for all of the police cadets and current officers.
Just to clarify, the officers in that scenario were responding to a radio call from the public.
But he was at a recital.
The next speaker, Robert Kristen.
With no other people around.
Why would you respond to somebody digging in the trash?
Hello, everybody.
Hello, Maya.
I just want to ground in the moment that we're alive in right now. Want to share everybody's gratitude for our life, blood, courage, truth, power. We're in here together. And folks are outside of here together. Just keep connecting, keep building, keep bridging. When I walked in here, I got to share space and hug Wakisha's mom. Wanna honor our mothers?
Yeah.
Wanna honor Wakisha's motherhood?
Yes.
Yes.
Wanna honor our people who are in courts right now?
Yes.
Yes.
Our people who are locked up right now?
Yes.
Yes.
Inside our minds too, inside our homes, on the block. It was really disgusting. It was really gross. It is intense and nasty to witness this.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We have so much courage, power to be here.
Yeah.
They're armed with all of this lies and violence. A staff. Think about our ancestors in 1781. They're here with us too. They went through that step moment, and they here follow the legacy of the stamp.
Right.
It grosses me out to see our folks of color, our queer folks. Mm-hmm. Hello, folks.
Down.
They're not awake.
He's not looking to be used.
Yeah.
It's gross. Yeah. So gross.
Yeah. Thank you for your time.
I ask, call, that they resign.
Yes.
Get on the freedom side!
Yes. 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 Yes.
Ma'am, please have a seat so we can go on for the next speaker.
Step down, Bustamante. Step down, Cynthia. Step down.
We'll continue to focus here. In our power,
right, right.
And our
right.
Healing,
right.
And our justice, and our truth.
Yeah.
We're feeling,
yeah.
And we honor Wakisha Wilson today. We honor you, you're present here with all of us.
Yes.
Wakisha Wilson, say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
Say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
Say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
Yeah.
get everyone to have a seat, please? We can continue.
I want to go out. I want to go out.
They're
going to
trap us in now? They're
going to
trap us in? You can't go out and say,
go away, sister. Everyone to have a seat so we can continue.
What? You need to let people leave. You need to let people leave. You need to let people leave.
Are we trapped? Are we trapped in?
Public door.
Are we trapped right now?
De-escalate.
You know, we want to try real hard. It's going to be fun with y'all. And y'all doing this stuff. Like, we're really trying here.
We have order, please. If you want to stay in the room for the meeting, then please have a seat. If you want to leave, then please do so.
Yes,
the fact that there's a mother here, and we are willing, so willing to traumatize her after the fact that her daughter was killed by the same, it's the most inhumane thing that I have ever witnessed. This mother here has cried multiple times in this facility, has had to leave because of the amount of traumatization that you are forcing on her. The same traumatization that you enforced on her daughter. The same system that has murdered, regardless of how you guys want to paint it, her daughter, she is now being forced to sit through and witness. And the fact that you guys can sit here smugly is disgusting. It's really disgusting. This woman has lost her fucking daughter, and you guys are traumatizing her. You are traumatizing her. And you guys are sitting there smugly, not even looking, not even participating in the conversation. It is the most disgusting act of power that I have ever seen in my life. It is disgusting that you guys are able to, this woman is powerful. The ability for her to sit here right now and listen to you guys go on about use of force, and to see all of these pigs surround her, and to put her in a situation like that to get justice for her daughter, after you guys waited days to tell her that her fucking child was murdered?
Right.
If anybody did that to you, if somebody killed your child, and then waited days to let you know about it, you would want vengeance. You would want a Helen of Troy. You would want
justice.
Something. Justice. And the fact that you are willing to put this woman, look at her. Look at what you have fucking done. Look at what you have done. Look at what you, this woman is sitting right here. And you guys don't even give a fuck. Say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
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 Wakisha Wilson.
Wakisha Wilson.
Say her name.
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 Wakisha Wilson.
Wakisha Wilson.
Wakisha Wilson. Wakisha Wilson.
Next, etc.
She's missing.
The other ones? The other ones? Who tortured you and they wanted to kill you. So, a lot of bullshit we heard, but I guess what we didn't hear about the reality-based training is that when the LAPD trained El Salvadorian paramilitary squads in the 1980s. When the LAPD trained the Marine Corps in 2003 and 2004 on counterinsurgency tactics by taking over South Central Los Angeles.
Speak on it.
When the LAPD trains with the Israeli Defense Forces of an open season
that's
of
right.
killing people.
That's right.
That's the reality-based training that we're not going to hear about.
Say that. Right.
Because that's exactly that is practiced on us. And then we saw this slide about building public trust. Constitutional policing, mental illness, crowd control, it all comes down to legal liability. Crowd control, 2007, MacArthur Park. Crowd control, 2014, the largest number of arrests. Crowd control, right after the election, the largest number of arrests. So what we are dealing with is something, again, as we keep on saying to them, something being fundamentally flawed by design. We didn't hear anybody speak about the institution that is rotten to the core. The institutional culture that is built on racism, that is built on violence, that is built on conspiracy. The programs and tactics on the ground that force people into conditions where excessive use of force until lethal force will be used. Predictive policing, suspicious activity reporting, EZL-4.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. These are conditions on the ground. And then the internal review process, where zero sustain, zero.
None.
Right? And then you have, who do we have here? The shock absorbers of the system. So when you bring it all together, we see this full cycle coming up, and right in the middle it says, flawed by design. So they can give us all of this garnishing, they can give us all of this smokescreen, they can give us all of these videos, they can give us all of this jargon about constitutional policing, but the fact will still remain that last year LAPD murdered the most people of any police department.
Right, right. Say that.
The fact will still remain in 2015, LAPD murdered the most people of any police department. The fact will still remain that LAPD, one-third of the people that they killed were mentally ill.
Yes.
So of course, when we speak about Wakisha Wilson, this is nothing out of the normal. So say her name!
Wakisha Wilson!
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 Yeah.
Say her name, Wakisha Wilson.
Wakisha Wilson.
When you take the life of someone's family member, any member, you should have regards to what life really is and appreciate that moment.
Right, especially you, Steve Sobrock, the Barbara.
Hold on, it's my turn. You mentioned, Steve, that bipolar people are not welcome to Los Angeles.
Wow.
It makes us wonder whether or not this commission has some bipolar people who take no consideration for life, like under the ADA Title I and Title II, 131, 132 discrimination against a person with a mental disability. Better let's go to Section 504 Rehabilitation Act of 1990, Mr. Johnson, or should I say Uncle Tom?
Right, I should say that too, because I'm more well focused than further behind. We advocate on behalf of the public's interest, and most people get upset because they like our cute comments.
But little do you forget, when the Encino lawyer was being harassed, retaliated against Herb Wesson, the city of Los Angeles LAPD, the TMUs, Threat Management Unit, the TROs, he had no choice but to file two federal lawsuits in order to get you from killing him. He had to go before the public in shame and stand here and back himself up. Because you sent someone to his home to scare him. At his home with that knife. You tried to kill the man.
That's what happened. That's what you did. That's what you did.
So it's no wonder, no surprise, you have an outcry of contemptuous people here against you. Yes, we're scorned.
Very scorned. And angry, but not objective to your tactics. All the city charter for the record and policy and procedure under the government standard.
Thank you for your comments, sir.
There are no other comment cards on this item. We're now on item number 3, report of the Chief of Police, Chief Beck.
Good afternoon, Commissioner. I'm sad to report the death of Police Reserve Officer Michael Wade. Passed away yesterday, 29-year veteran of the Reserve Corps of the Los Angeles Police Department. He died as a result of injuries sustained while making a theft arrest in an off-duty job. Very sad, survived by his wife, Jennifer, His son John and Kevin were both active duty, one with the Air Force, one with the Marine Corps. Yesterday we had an off-duty officer involved shooting. A very officer was at his residence in Downing at 3:30 in the morning. He became aware of two individuals in his front yard area. He responded. There was a physical altercation, and an officer involved shooting occurred. The officer was significantly injured by physical force, and both suspects sustained gunshot wounds from which they were apparently recovered. There's much investigation that we do on this. The officer is still medicated. I think they'll be doing an interview more completely today, so we'll have more information. Over the past week, Los Angeles Police Department has taken the opportunity in the national conversation to reaffirm our belief that immigration enforcement is not in the province of local law enforcement, and we've taken the opportunity to do that on the local and on the national stage. Crime picture early in the year, so the comparison doesn't mean much. We're two homicides over last year. Overall violent crime is down about 5%. Overall Part 1 crime also down about 5%. Shootings are about even. But of course, this is very, very early on, and these numbers will change. Traffic numbers are the same way. You know, I think I'll wait a little while before I start giving those out. It's very volatile at the moment. We have 9,904 sworn personnel on payroll with 53 recruits in the county not yet being paid. So that brings us pretty close to the 10,000, which we have not been at for the last couple of years. So those are positive things. Recruitment is doing a better job of filling our academy. 2,779 civilian personnel. That's 498 fewer than we are allocated. Continues to stress the department and require the use of sworn officers to do some civilian jobs. We have about 400 reserve officers, about 300 specialist volunteers, 57 chaplain counselors, and 8,411 young people in our cadet program. And that concludes my report.
I just wanted to support, Chief. I think your words on the immigration issue on the national scale have been right on target. And, on behalf of the department and support the feelings.
We have 7 comment cards. We have the first 4, Prentice Jenkins, Michael Novick, Wayne Fermancino, Yvonne Michelle Autry. Mr. Jenkins? Michael Novick?
Hi, good evening, honorables. Police Commission, and my condolences go out to all the families on both sides.
Both sides?
What are you talking about?
Hold on. When you have the mic, when it is your time, don't
stop. They never called his name.
Can you state your name for the
record? State your name.
No, I'm trying to get facts here.
Dunton.
We have a
partner. I haven't called his name yet.
We haven't called your name.
Sit down.
It's
more
John.
Okay, moving right along.
Prentice Jenkins, Michael Novick, Wayne Fermancino, and Yvonne Michelle Autry.
He owns the building.
Call it for instance.
Prentice Jenkins, he's not here. Michael Novick, not present. Wayne Fermancino. Michelle Autry.
I mean, the prior speaker, he's one of the people that owns the building. He can speak anytime. So anyway, so that was a great report. Yes, thank you, the tireless, fearless chief. You ran down there to the court. You got the marshals. You ran down to LAX Saturday night. And you got all those refugees off those planes. and defied federal law in the name of the immigrant. You're so brave. Bullshit! You were there like the little Nazis we know you are.
Yep.
Today's Nazi is Mr. Trump and his stupid ass order. Do you aware, Cynthia, I know the others don't give a fuck about any of this, is that you got a green card and your country of birth is Iran. No matter how long you've been here, this motherfucker president was not going to let you back in the United States again. What the fuck is that? How can a police officer at LAX allow that shit to happen?
Yeah, it's part of the LAX.
How the fuck can you? And there's no way, see, but you see federal funds. Today, your little master, Mr. Trump's got that federal money. And you do anything for the money. Anything, right? That's what Steve, he lived his whole life doing that. What Matt does, he works for the man. That's what all these people do.
Not the man.
He is the man. Well, you know. So the point is that you know it's bullets for dollars.
Wow.
Kill the people in the redevelopment zones. Take the land and rezone it.
Right.
Build more affordable housing. No. Place more people as homeless while you gentrify. That's the police report I want to hear. Next time, next week, please say, I am Chief Charlie Beck. And I'm sorry I murder and kill and beat innocent people, but I have to do it. That's my job. And then we can have a good conversation.
Thank you, James.
Prentice Jenkins, peace between residents and police.
Say what?
Peace between residents and police. The Honorable Matt Johnson, good to see you.
They will never let
Honorable
you sit
Steve
with
Sobral, good to see you. Chief, good to see you too. That was really disturbing about Wakisha Wilson. I'm really disturbed about that. I'm also disturbed about the fact that Ezell Ford's murderers won't be prosecuted. That's on the district attorney, Chief. That's not on you. I'm still hoping something will come from that, but maybe it won't. The truth of the matter is, we're still going to need peace, folks. There's got to be peace between the residents and police. How are we going to do that?
Get rid of police.
Police ain't going nowhere.
Yes, they are.
Residents aren't going anywhere. So I decided that a bridge must be
built. No.
I intend to build a bridge with the help of my compatriots. With the help of my compatriots.
Hold on. Whether you agree with what the person who's at the speaker stand says or not, it is their right to have their time uninterrupted. We don't interrupt them whether we agree or disagree. Everybody in this room has their time to speak on every item, and I expect everybody to be given the respect of that time. And if you don't, you'll be asked to leave, and we will just keep pausing the clock and giving the person more time. So add 10 seconds, we'll wait 10 seconds before you move there.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. There will be peace between the residents and police. If I have anything to do with it, there will be. And just as my esteemed colleague told me, only 1% of them are bad. The other 99% need our support. So I'm here to support you. I'm here to support the chief. I'll continue to support the chief. And I'll continue to speak out against that 1% that harm residents in this community. That's not gonna continue. But peace between residents and police will continue.
And
trust me, if I have anything to say about it, my colleagues, those that are helping, have anything to say about it, it will come to fruition. Thank you.
That's right. That's right.
Yvonne Michelle Autry, followed by Trevor Gerard, Michael Williams, and Mr. Herman.
Well, I'd like to really speak in support of what Mariela was trying to express here. I'd also like to take this a step further and pray for your soul, because you have to be set free in freeing the information for this mother and for all of the families, giving closure to all of the families of whose children's lives you have taken. What I'd like to say is that the police, unless we are under martial law, and I continually speak against the funding of a police state, we have no power to mete out justice. I speak against the CIA torture chambers, the use of illegal weaponry, like the electronic weapons that people don't even know that they're using to torture our people. They're just shooting one in the head and raping and murdering black women. That's not all they're doing. They're using electronic weapons to debilitate, to damage us, to have justification, to put us in prisons and in hospitals, and they're doing further experimentation on us. I'd like to speak against the research. I'm so sick and tired of white women following me, talking about this is a test subject, the science project. I'm not your test subject, science project for military international training purposes, and I'm not the only person. No offense, I'm sick of Latinas following me to my, she needs her shots and medication. And I'm not a racist, but I know I'm not the only one, and it has nothing to do with race. It's maintenance of status quo for people who have the energy and the intellect to create change that they do not want to happen. What I'd like to say also is regarding the issue about releasing the videos. Again, we have to incriminate and you have to prosecute the police officers that you know are responsible, that are guilty, in order to separate if there are any positive police officers, and I do believe they are. We know that you might be pawns in the Illuminati, okay, and that you're all given orders, but you still have a conscience, you have a responsibility to the community, and we will continue to show up until you honor that responsibility. Wakisha
Wilson.
Say your name.
Wakisha Wilson.
Say your name.
Wakisha Wilson.
So it's interesting to note that Charlie Beck feels that Magnum P.I. Tom Selleck was based on him. which is relevant, because he's a relic and you're a relic too. That's why you sat up there in that busted-ass 70s suit, right? And everybody comes up here and... and does these presentations with all these smart acronyms, right? Well, I got one for you, and it's MURDER. Mothers Under Real Duress Eventually Rising. How long do you think it's going to be before the streets flood with people demanding justice? You and all your officers will never be able to stop that, right? So you can sit up here, look, the police are little more than the domestic military arm of the United States government. I don't care that you made a press conference saying that you weren't going to do the bidding. You're a slave, just like everybody else, right? And you need the money. This ain't your shit. This is their shit, right? And the minute that you don't toe the line, they will fire your ass. And I also find it really interesting that Matt Johnson's last name is a white people's term for a dick. Right? Because that's all he's contributed to doing is fucking over the black community, right? Black is a political identity, and I wear it proudly. Matt Johnson is not a black man. He's a person who happens to have a black parent. And hence, I have no mercy or compassion in me for a system that will crush people and then penalize them for not being able to stand up under the way.
I wear Wakisha Wilson on my arm because that's my fighting arm.
Sure.
That's why I'm paying on this table. To sit up here and have all this stuff and y'all carrying on with this meeting, y'all know what this woman is here for. She wants to find out what happened to her daughter because you lied.
Right.
Specifically, you lied to her. And your officers lied to her. First, y'all said she hung herself from a telephone pole cord. And then when people actually went to the jail and figured out that that was not possible, then you changed it up to say that she was unresponsive in her cell. So which one is it? Because it can't be both.
Right.
That's what you said, Charlie Beck. So either you're lying or your officer's lying. Either way, you're lying.
They're all lying.
Either way, you're lying.
We are here for Wakisha Wilson because she has been killed. And y'all have affirmed it by having this decision here in this meeting. Because y'all don't
right.
Okay.
Wow.
So y'all are just admitting that she has been killed by your officers. And y'all have to find out whether or not it's in policy. We know you're coming back and you're gonna say it's in policy because whatever reason that y'all come up and excuse it, you won't show the video to the mother, you won't show the video to the public, because you know if you show the video to the public would be up here in arms. So you keep it behind closed doors. Just like you've been trying to keep her murder around it under closed doors. But people have been figuring it out and calling you out. Y'all need to have some kind of check with yourself and quit. This whole commission needs to be dismantled because you're covering up and you're sustaining and you're apologizing for and you're legalizing the murder of black people.
Yes. Right. Yeah. Mr. Herman?
Surprise for you. I called the officers. It starts like this. Britney, Shakespeare's tree. While George Bernard Shaw, George Bernard Shaw shamed his redemption. Mary shelled out monstrous advice. While Bram stoked the desires of bloodlust. Oscar's wild antics were responsible for breaking told stories. And John Stein beckoned the angry fruits of his labor. And in conclusion, F. Scott fits Gerald's shoes perfectly. Thank you.
Okay.
Michael Novick. John Denton. Melina Dula.
Get him, Kay. Get him, Kay.
So there was a lot of bullcrap on this agenda, which I feel is extremely disrespectful. This should have been an agenda only on Wakisha Wilson.
Yeah. This
is more of your PR stuff. We know what it is. And it was hugely disrespectful to the family.
Yes.
Because it's public comment, I want to also lift up for the next meeting that Charlie Beck still hasn't disciplined the officers Charlton Wampler and Antonio Villegas, who murdered Ezell Ford. You all found that they were out of policy. And your job is to hold him accountable. Right, remember what he did after you issued your ruling. He goes on Cold Circuit TV and says, and this is a quote, to his officers, don't worry about it, here's a quote, I'll protect you, the mayor will protect you, and that protection will protect you like the vest that you wear. Protecting murderous officers. So are you like the rest of the politicians who are working for him, working for the police union, who I know they say they don't like him, but when they get down together, they get down together? Are you going to actually hold him accountable? Are you going to hold him accountable?
Yeah.
Hold him accountable. Do your job. Do your job. Stop being a tool. Steve Soboroff, you can look away if you want to, but this is your job. And if you don't want to do it, step the hell off.
Yeah.
Step the hell off. I think it's firing Charlie Beck. This is, what do they call it? Willful insubordination. It's insubordination.
Yes.
You are subordinate to them. They don't work for you. You work for them. Fire Charlie Beck.
Please.
Fire Charlie Beck. Fire Charlie Beck. Fire Charlie Beck. Fire Charlie Beck! Fire Charlie Beck! Fire Charlie Beck!
Today!
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 Fire Charlie Beck!
Fire Charlie Beck!
Who's next?
So this is gonna also adjust Chief Beck's comment about, the stupid things that he comments about. So with the executive orders being brought by the Trump administration, we're seeing this the continued rise of hate towards the other. You look into this room and we are the others, the black and brown bodies the state fears. We know that Trump wants to bring back law and order and respect and protection for police officers, but also is determined to stifle the movement for black lives and the movement to end the violence of policing. So how does LAPD fit into this Trump administration? Chief Beck may claim that he will defy Trump's executive orders on deportation, but we know that once a body is in your custody, the deportation process begins, guilty or innocent. Special Order 40 protects no one. And people know this, and this will not divide us. LAPD exemplifies state violence and how it operates at its core. You are Trump. The profiling, abuse, tragedy, or targeting of black lives demonstrates how the state how the state kills and incarcerates with impunity. Under the executive order that gives Border Patrol agents the discretion to decide who is a potential criminal, we know we see the same discretion given to law enforcement whenever they encounter a black body. Under the Suspicious Activity Reporting Initiative, all they need is reasonable indication, or better stated, all they need is to be black and criminality is assumed. We see the same order, in the same order, the commitment to increase ICE and Border Patrol agents, and again, we see LAPD claiming the same thing, desiring more police and wanting more detention centers. Your predictive policing programs that originated in Iraq and Afghanistan, tracking and tracing insurgents, are used here in our community, black and brown and poor communities, seeing us as hotbeds of domestic terrorists. We must center the continued murdering of black lives and the structure and culture that allows this to happen at the center of the conversation. It is the same structure the Trump administration is putting into place, and just like we are showing up to protest and defy you, the public is showing up to protest Trump. You are Trump, your LAPD is his domestic army.
Yeah.
Honorable City Council and everyone here. My name is John Beckman, and I am part of the Wrigley family of Catalina Island. I'm here because December 31, 1997, there was an 8-year-old boy. His father was gunned down by a gunman, Steve Gohara from Hollenbeck Division. The next one was also Landon Doris from Northeast. In fact, I met Steve's family. Also, I made Landon Dorsen's family. And you know what? He had two kids and a fiance, but he got hit by just a driver driving. He was writing a ticket. Third was Randy Simmons in the Valley, and the fourth one was Nick Lee. Let me tell you something. I want everybody never to get the fallen, including our military. We are the ones that put a reef outside this door that says Fallen Hills.
People that died.
Missed but never forgotten. But that's also including our military. The important thing is that there's a lot of hatred in this room. But no.
Righteousness is basic.
Hold the clock.
We hate racism. We hate white supremacist racism.
We have 36 cards. We've given everyone their 2 minutes. We could have cut it down to 1 minute. If the speaker does not give the respect and their time on the mic, there won't be a public comment.
Oh, no! That lady was so mad.
Excuse me, back there in the hat, you've interrupted this meeting many, many times. If you interrupt again, I'm gonna ask you to leave.
Okay.
Now, please, there are over 30. If you interrupt the meeting again, I'm going to ask you to leave. It's that simple. I've given you many chances.
Give me video, and I'll leave.
I don't have to give you a video.
Show video, and we will leave.
There are over 30 speakers left. If we continue to have interruptions, we're not going to have public comment. So please give the speakers their time on the mic. Please continue. Sorry for the
interruption. Yes. There's a lot of hatred in the room.
No.
The answer doesn't lie in this room. The answer, these people don't know what I know.
Wow!
Oh, my God.
Okay, white man.
Stop the clock again.
Man, you gonna let that go on?
He has his time on the mic, just like you do. Just like you do. If you continue to interrupt, I'm going to ask you to leave too.
Excuse me.
If you continue to interrupt, I'm going to ask you to leave too. Wait 10 seconds before you start the clock. Please continue.
The answer doesn't lie with the people here. It doesn't lie with the police department. It lies in Washington, D.C. Those were reports done in 1982, it's never been disclosed. And this report was of the neighborhoods in South Central, East LA, and everywhere. The federal government doesn't want to give money to the poor areas. The First AME Church has tried to do a lot in South Central to help the people. But like I said, the answer doesn't lie with them, it doesn't lie with you. The biggest mistake here is the federal government not giving funds to the neighborhoods to help you know, bring recreation and things that will stop the crime. But you guys gotta know, it's Washington, D.C., not here and not you. Thank you.
Poverty is a problem.
Karen Hilton, followed by Wayne from Encino, Yvonne Michelle Autry, and Pete White.
Doors to discuss LAPD personnel's involvement in Wakisha Wilson's death. I'd like to ask you to consider first and foremost how precious her life was. Second, to consider that she was in your care, dependent on you for everything. And custody, which I looked up in the dictionary, means care, guardianship, keeping, safekeeping, and protection. Something in your house, on your watch, went horribly and disastrously wrong. Third, that it matters. Her life matters, her life as a black woman matters, her family matters, and your lack of transparency, which was so eloquently spoken to by so many before, is shameful, and that matters. The police work for us, and they keep throwing out bitter and insulting quotes. This is your opportunity, and you're too late to step up and do your job or step down. Wakisha Wilson, say her name.
Wakisha Wilson!
So, what have we learned today? Today, this other gentleman from the Wrigley family said, I told you we own the building, you should have listened to me. And if he wasn't, if his family wasn't such a dumb motherfucker, they'd still own the Catalina Island today, you know, but they had to sell it. So, he talks about Washington, D.C. causing all of this. So, that's because he's got a 1992 report. Was FBI operations infiltrating inner cities with crack to hook people on a cause of dystopia
for redevelopment. Weed and Seed.
1992, this is 2017. So this guy, Wrigley, you know, he's got to get into the 21st century. But what we got here today is this lady, her attorney, they came here today, watched your bullshit, and they know. They know you killed her daughter. They know it. And you know it. So why don't you just submit it? In death custody. In custody death. She's been killed by you. For what reason? What reason? Why did it happen? Because you people are just assholes about everything. That's why. Maybe she wanted to make a phone call. Maybe she wanted to make an extra phone call. And they got a little angry. They pushed her down.
Yeah.
Right. Cracked her skull. Accidentally.
Right.
So, you got the video.
Right.
Where's the FBI? Why don't the FBI get the video?
Right.
Why do they sit there? Why? And he talks about Washington. Let's get the feds in here and clean this shit up and get the video.
Right.
And broadcast it over there in the jumbotron at Dodger Stadium. I want to see what the fuck happened.
Right. Michelle Autry, followed by Pete White, Sheila Brim, and Michael Cummings.
Yes, I'd like to speak against the drone and illegal surveillance that is increasing because of this police state, which is being used to incriminate and to demonize innocent people more frequently. Misdiagnosis of mental disease and bipolar schizophrenic psychotic paranoid and delusional, not only to justify the experimentation of our people, much like Tuskegee, which was not the last or the only experiment perpetrated on the best of our people and covered up. This is a government cover up. I would like to expose the fact that
these false documents, SARs, which are suspicious activity reports, I'm going to go police department. I've no gun. What y'all scared of? You're covering up. What are you covering up? So what I'm saying is you're covering up the fact that you are not only committing genocide against the people, a spirit which you cannot murder. You cannot stop the message or the messenger. But you're justifying and covering up the fact that you're using these women as sex slaves. Right. You're covering the fact that you're doing experiments to see how you can use a hot shot to get more mind control to control the people and then exterminating the survivors and the witnesses that are bearing witness to these horrible attacks on our minds and our bodies and our people. Just for the record, we are not the problem. We are not the sex goddesses. We are not, as per Israeli intelligence says it for me, because I'm not a Jewish woman, you know, that to be considered a substandard person. But again, in relishing certain desirable parts of my body, as my brother Prentice speaks widely on, we are not to be used as special sex slaves, to be exploited sexually as research specimens, sex goddesses, seductresses, temptresses, the super hot caliente from the Mexican mafioso point of view, which also exploit black women. I'm sick of it. I'm sick of it. And it's coming from the higher ups, and you know, we're not going to regress in the continued mistreatment and exploitation of our women or the murders of our men, our young sons, or anyone else in our community. You can keep white, please. Pete White, followed by Sheila Brim and Michael Cummings.
I'm Wakisha's auntie. This just could do the bullshit. Okay? Because Officer number one investigated officer number two.
Right.
Officer number two investigated officer number three. Officer number three investigated officer number four. So they get their little written report out and give it to the house nigger. Mm. And the house nigger give it to Girlie Beck, and come up and say, no, no, you guys who wrote this report, no, change it, change it. Mm-hmm. That was right what happened, but no, we need to change it. Because our department is on the line, and people going to be watching us. Right. So we got to change this, we got to cover this up. We got to say suicide.
Right.
We can't let this get out like that. We got to cover this up. Because we all know. We all know that she was killed. I don't care how many times you look at the video. You guys, I don't care. I don't care what you write in the report, because what all you wrote in the report are a bunch of lies.
Yes.
Because she did not take her life. She would take her life. Why would she take her life if she got a 14-year-old son now? Mm. Her birthday is coming up on Saturday, February the 4th. Mm. And how did you stole my birthday by killing her on March 27th? Ooh. Now how the hell do you think I'm going to go on March 27th? Mm. For the rest of my life. Jesus. And you, son, the house nigga, You let all this go on. You let all this BS go on while my sister's sitting here. Ooh, we've been here, what, 2 hours?
Longer than that.
We tried to be nice. We tried to, you know, be settled, you know? But, you know, I'm shaking in my seat. Listen to these officers with that damn report. And here's a delicate, a sensitive matter about Wakisha's death need to be addressed.
Right.
But you let these motherfuckers go on with that with different sizes, different colors, different shapes. You don't know who going back saying what.
Come on, man. Get the camera out of
my
face.
I don't trust no motherfucking body from this place. No L.A. who killed my niece. You think I'm supposed to trust them? You robbed me of my birthday. You robbed her of her life. You robbed her son of his mother.
Yeah.
You robbed my sister of her daughter. And to have her sit here, coming here every Tuesday. Then you try to make it inconvenience and have it at 8 o'clock. And thought we weren't going to show up. Keep changing and changing. And then how the hell you say suicide on day one? And now you investigate it and you now always come to the conclusion that it's suicide. But day one, without investigating, you said it was suicide. Do you know what that took us through? Doing a GoFundMe to bury her. Because the insurance policy
wouldn't cover suicide.
Wouldn't cover it. Do you know how much embarrassing? You know what we went through? Do y'all know what we went through to bury her? No, you don't know. Because when I was first up here, when I first started coming, you guys didn't give a fuck. You know why? Because you sat here on your damn computer, looking down, you apologized while you was texting.
You still do it.
That's why I know you don't care. And I'm really disgusted. The attorney, I said for the attorney's sake, I was going to be cool and calm. But after this bullshit right here, sent through all this, fuck every last one of y'all.
Say my name.
And every time something happens, we have to stop and put somebody out. And I'm just trying to get them back home. It's just lingering the process on. And she's over there grieving. The auntie's grieving. So if people get up and speak for now, please, let's keep our comments to ourselves. Because it's just lingering on. We should have been out here a long time ago with the comments. Well, good morning. My name is Pastor Mike Cummings. I'm with We Care Outreach Ministry. I'm part of the Watch Gang Task Force. I come out of the community of Watts, also represent the National Action Network Watts chapter with the great Reverend Al Sharpton. I'm here today to speak on behalf of Wakisha Wilson, Lisa Hines, and the family. We grew up with them in Watts. A lot of the Watts people didn't get involved, but now it's becoming a problem. As we protect our schools through the day with our safe passage programs, as we do intervention in the community. While I was sitting here, we had a shooting at 107th and Central. My phone was blown up so we can get in between the situation. But what I'm saying now, as we watch Lisa Hines travel from home to the bus stop or through the community, she's crying. She's heartache, she's pain, she's grieving. And the community now is asking, what's really going on? I don't know if some of y'all know me or not, but I don't come out to these commissioners' meetings a lot. I just don't. When it happened, I didn't come. Reverend Tunis came from the National Action Network, even though that we had a Watts chapter, and Lisa Hines grew up in Watts. But I was called in now to come in, because we need to get something done about this situation. Yes. I'm asking on behalf of the family, on behalf of Wakisha Wilson, I want you to just close your eyes for a few seconds. And I'm asking everybody to put themselves in the shoes of Lisa Hines as she comes to the office, to the police, or wherever, to the courts, or whatever, to see her daughter.
And then she was turned away. Then she came Tuesday. She was turned away. Then she came again. And she ended up with a letter, I mean a note, a pencil, I mean a number, and it's the coroner's office. As you close your eyes today, I'm going to tell you, I don't know where I would be if that happened to my daughter. But Lisa Hines and the family is real strong. And I'm asking the commissioner, Dr. Charlie Beck, here, the chief of police, the same way the incident went down on 108th and Western, it could have got real crazy, but everybody was on the ground. But because you released that video, the community heartbeat died down. If it is a video, for whatever it showed, Commissioner Chief Beck, please release it. If you don't want to release it, please just take the family and you and the commission board and look at the video. Give Mama some closure. Give Lisa Hines some closure. Because I'm gonna tell you something, she was a mother, she carried this child 9 months. She struggled to get her to the point where she at. In order for us to continue to move forward, I'm asking this commission board, and I'm asking you, Charlie Beck, please take Lisa and let me see this video, because it's just a lot. I'm for community police. I deal with the community when things come down and watch. And we stand. But here it is now. How can we stand if our community member is hurt? That's all I'm asking. You ain't got to show the world. You got to show. Take Lisa and the family and show them the video. And when everybody else come up here from now on, let's move forward. Let's move forward. Because we got to get Lisa Hines back home. We didn't come to stay all day.
Thank you. Next question, we have Kevin Gerard. Christina Gutierrez, Audrey George.
We're gonna have all Watts up in here if nothing don't happen.
Sade.
They on the back burner right now. But if some changes don't be made, God has already revealed to me as I studied this scripture. For 7 days, 7 nights, meditated on it. The Lord said, vengeance is mine. I will repay. And as I sleep, as I was sleeping, as I was waking, you know what I see? Red dots. Red dots on foreheads. Let Watts come in this motherfucker.
Trevor George, please.
Y'all have no power to give these people justice, and you know that. So you might as well stop bullshitting.
Yeah, that's all it is, bullshit.
Right. This is so the power is here, not here. This is a facade, this is a farce. This is a show, and it can be broken just as easily as Charlie Beck's pelvis. Right? And I told you, didn't I? I told you, men fall down steps, men have heart attacks, men have strokes.
You sure did say that.
Right? And then it happened.
You better be careful.
Because when we align ourselves with injustice, right, we open ourselves up to all kinds of things. And this is not a threat. Right, don't hit me with no temporary restraining order like your houseboy Matt Johnson tried to do. Right? And then lied in the damn thing, so we know you're liars, right? So all I want to do is take the last minute and actually respect the life of Wakisha Wilson, and we'll just have a moment of silence.
Say your name. Wakisha Wilson!
Speaker Christina Gutierrez.
Audrey George.
Followed by Ann Wilson. And Davey Chet.
Regarding your new efforts that you were discussing to give timely public response to police use of force, I demand that part of that new policy be that you refrain from referring to the victims of police killings as being gang members, perpetrators of a crime, looking as though they were about to commit a crime, being armed with knives, etc. Stop maligning people who will never be able to refute those slurs.
Thank you.
And who will never be able to confront their accusers. Stop subjecting their loved ones to this further trauma. Stop invalidating accusations by communities of color that they are racially profiled, criminalized, and murdered by the LAPD by suggesting that these are perceptions rather than reality. Wakisha Wilson did not commit suicide. Therefore, it is a reality, a fact, that she was a victim of fatal violence from her jailers. Right. This closed session you will be participating in is a test to see if this commission can claim to have any integrity at all. We will be waiting for you to report your findings. Hold her killers accountable and responsible.
Speaker Ahmadi.
I was made so-called targeted individual. They torture me day and night, 24 hours, with electromagnetic radiation, with laser burning. They put poison in my food. They made me deaf, blind, gave me cancer, gave me 10 other diseases, non-stop. And I hope you will call. Help me. Police is not helpful at all. I was under the impression that it was done by the feds, but lately I found out that police is actively involved in this torture. And no wonder they hide all this, try to hide, and they try to present that I'm crazy. I have to be afraid of them because they have the power of arrest. In November, last November, I tried to call police, and they came to the door of the building and left. They did not enter. I called second time, insisted. They did come, did not leave business card, anything. They said, we'll be back, and disappeared. I insisted. They came the third time in the morning, and this time they left the note that 5150, meaning I'm crazy, and left again. They do not take reports.
Sir, thank you.
And they prepared the story that I'm crazy and must be placed in the mental institution. And this is why I cannot ask for protection. And I'm suffering enormously. I tried to contact.
They're doing this. They're doing this.
I was unable to come here.
Look at the cards.
Time's up.
Look, come here, sit down. They're doing this. They don't care. The CIA, they're doing this.
We'll have someone come and speak to you.
They're experimenting.
Sir, we'll have someone come and speak to you, okay?
Just like me. Well, they will kill you. Look, there's a, I know a commission, and we can sue them.
Okay. Speaker Ann Wilson.
And they will call you crazy, and they will hospitalize you. But you have to listen. They're doing this. They're getting paid to do this. Here, listen. Now, the city council's approved $7.6 million
for body cameras. The public is expecting that things are going to get better. The public is expecting that things are going to be okay now. You have a chance. You have a chance to implement your own policy, to be a leader, to make sure that video footage is released immediately and that there are repercussions for any tampering with equipment. On an airplane, it is illegal to tamper with a fire detector on an airplane. So shouldn't there be some kind of repercussion for tampering with police video surveillance equipment that we paid $57.6 million for? The prophecy that the sister talked about, we're in a situation now where the citizens of LA, they think this $57.6 million is gonna make everything better. Be prepared for people to go ballistic the next time something happens and there's not police footage. Be prepared for people to keep fighting for the footage of Wakisha Wilson. You have a chance to be a leader and not have to wait on some statewide measure or some citywide measure that comes from the public demanding the release. You have a chance now to do it on your own. But that's leaving us, the slack here is leaving us no choice but to rally for this to be a statewide measure that's within 6 hours, we want some footage if we pay $57 million for it. $57 million is what we're paying over 5 years for these cameras. So the two things we need, if we don't get it from you, then we'll have to do it other ways. We'll have to get the city council to go back. And the people you see in this room that are here, missing work, missing jobs, children in daycare, this is just a fragment of the people citywide who are on edge and they're watching. Don't let it come to that. Be a leader. Enact your own policies, repercussions for tampering with equipment, and release within 6 to 12 hours. You have the ability to be a leader. And right now, last thing, we cannot say that LA is a leader in transparency. We cannot say that LA is a leader in transparency. Because the city of LA, LAPD is 10 times larger than every other police department in the state. So to say that we're a leader in releasing video footage is kind of an insult to our intelligence. Let us be a leader in releasing it. For real.
Right now, I keep going over my head about something I can say, something that can come out, but I think that everything that could possibly get you guys to move has been said. I think that we have cried, and we have begged, and we've tried everything. We've tried everything that we can, and nothing's going to be done, and nothing has been done, and nothing will ever come of this. I think that it is shameful that we have to continue coming here to beg you, to fight with you, to get angry, to show you our hurt, because you guys continue to do it. They continue to do it, and there's no sorrow in the fact that you have, there's no guilt. The fact that you can sit here with family members of the people that you guys have assaulted and not think about the fact that you're traumatized, it's incredible to me. I'm going to leave out with a song, actually, because I can hear my neighbors crying, I can't breathe, and now I'm in the struggle.
I can't leave, fighting for the violence of your racist police. And we ain't gonna stop till the people are free. Said we ain't gonna stop till our people are free.
Victor Smith, followed by Michael Williams and Brittany.
All y'all up.
The longer we talk to them, the longer they're going to continue the murder and the lies.
I will be brief because I want to introduce another issue to this commission. My issue is as a taxpayer, a U.S. citizen. On September the 8th, 2016, I filed a complaint with the 77th Division Police Department. The complaint was never investigated. It is now being investigated by Internal Affairs. I have gone to 77th Street Division, spoken with the detectives. I get no respect. I get no answers, and I get no investigation. It is today that I have asked Chief Beck and this commission to assign an adjutant to me to look into this case and the conduct of his officers, and especially Detective Wood. I have a statement of facts here that I gave to Internal Affairs. I met with them, and during their preliminary investigation, they have told me that there are, at this point, it appears that there are officers in dereliction of duty. I attempted to contact the station commander, sent him a copy of this as well. He refused to acknowledge it or to get back with me. And this is in the practice. So I'm just asking that you look into this.
Thank you. Mr. Bustamante, can you have someone from your office speak to this gentleman, please? Mr. Bustamante is our inspector general, and someone from his office will speak to you.
Thank you.
Where is he? He's on the left end right there.
Well, that's a common occurrence for your officers is to not comply and not fill out reports. That's a common thing. A theme that comes to this commission. Time after time. I want to talk about the disrespect that you have shown for this family, because when we were having the moment of silence for Wakisha Wilson, you were all looking at your damn phone. Ooh. Matt Johnson, Figueroa, that's disrespectful. You show no respect by for one, having a meeting, keeping it over, having all these agenda items on the meeting, trying to prolong it. You show disrespect by not being able to even chant with us. When people ask for your mandate, which I will never do. I will never do that. Because I'm done with this commission. I want to see it gone. Because it's a false sense of reassurance. It's a false sense that there is some kind of community control over the police. Because there is not here. There is no community control over the police. So I'm not going to appeal to your humanity or your morals. I'm not going to do that. But people have. And people have asked you to chant with them. And say Wakisha Wilson's name, and you refuse. Say Ryan Joseph's name, you refuse. Say Carnell Snell's name, you refuse. So you don't care about the people who you killed, that your officers killed. And then you have the nerve that you don't even have to speak. Just sit in silence. For someone. And you can't even show that kind of courtesy. You can't even show the simple, decent respect that somebody gives another human being. It's terribly disrespectful. And that's my biggest issue with this commission, is that you are disrespectful to the family members who come here week after week begging for your help. And you sidestep them, and then you show them disdain for trying to show up and fight for their people's lives. Y'all are so disrespectful. And I pray that what all these people have been saying about people coming up here, I pray you never see that. Because it's not going to be pretty. Say her name!
Wakisha Wilson!
Say her name!
Wakisha Wilson!
Say her name!
Wakisha Wilson!
We done with this.
Sir? Brittany Quiet.
I'm sorry, excuse me for a moment. Sir, if you go to the back, one of my staff is right there, Jody Spatter. Please raise your hand, Jody. We'll be meeting you.
Thank you.
Brittany Quiet, not present. I do have 15 common cards with the name Wakisha Wilson.
Say her name.
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 I said
Wakisha Wilson.
Say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
Say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
Say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
For this item, we're now.
No, I think she's planning to call each card, and if you using Wakisha Wilson's name, and if you haven't spoken already and submitted a card under her name, then you're entitled to take to the mic and speak now. My name is Carl Douglas. I represent Lisa Hyde. And I did not intend to bring honor to her memory and to the memory of her daughter, Wakisha Wilson. I have been a civil rights lawyer for 35 years, and never have I had a client who has shown as much dedication and resolve as this time. She's been remarkable, and she is an inspiration to me. We are here asking for two things. As you go into the back to consider the enclosed in the items, she is interested in seeing the video herself.
Yes.
Yes.
If it requires please, that please. I must file a lawsuit in order for that to occur, then so be it.
Right.
Because justice demands that she see that video to gain closure in her own life. It's also important I speak to the way that she was treated by the department in terms of not being aware of the death of her family member. When you have someone, I've been here for 4 hours, when you have someone from Afghanistan who talks about their ability to notify family members 3 hours after their death, I think it is an abomination. It took 3 days for her to know about her own daughter's death. And the district attorney's office was clearly made aware that there had been a death because that would explain why her name was removed from the dockets.
Right.
It is an abomination that the mother was not made aware. So if anything can be done, I hope that you consider ways to improve that relationship to her. Because no mother ever have to experience what Lisa Hines has experienced. Can I end by saying, say her name.
Wakisha Wilson!
Thank you. Again, I appeal to the commission to end the suffering of Ms. Hines and release the tape. It just needs to happen, and I would really appreciate it if all of the commissioners could at least pay attention when people are speaking and not look down at their computers. I've noticed that a lot. And also, I want to make another appeal to you. I noticed there, my homeboy over there said that, my home person said that that we've tried every argument there is. Well, let me try another argument with y'all. And this is Schrodinger's equation. You know, I just saw Hidden Figures yesterday, so I'm still hyped on my man, all right? Right now, there are two states that exist when it comes to Wakisha Wilson. Until we see that tape, one of the things you get from Schrodinger's equation is that until you observe what happens, then both states exist. She has either committed suicide or she died by accident in police custody. And until there is, until there is an observation, both states exist simultaneously. And the only way that we're going to have anything definitive is through an observation. Until then, the cat is still alive. And until then, Wakisha is still being, her memory is still being held hostage. Her family is being held hostage. Everything about this situation is being on hold because we don't see the evidence. We're not asking you to do us any favor. We just want to understand what happened. And there is evidence of that. I mean, if you really believe that you are here to serve the people, then serve us. You've heard what the training people said they want to do. Now listen to what the people who experienced the LAPD want to see happen. Do this for, and not just do it, again, I have to appeal to your soul. Do it for us, do it for yourself, do it for your children, do it for the future. And you know, and I want to apologize for the vitriol that I've had today. I'm a Southern woman, I'm not used to being in this room to people. But at the same time, this woman died, and her mother is still suffering, her children are suffering, her auntie is suffering, and I just can't stand to sit here and let that happen. I drove all the way from Corona. I got up at 5 o'clock this morning just to be here for this, because this one, I believe in what's happening. I'm trying to believe that you people are people of justice. I'm trying to believe that Los Angeles is a city of angels. I'm trying to believe that maybe that Wakisha Wilson can get some justice. But I need y'all too. I need your faith. I need your action. I need everybody in this room to remember her. Wakisha Wilson.
Say it.
Wakisha Wilson.
I just want to take time to honor and uplift the mother of Wakisha Wilson, to honor the courage to be here. We leave the school district and have a list of demands. That we would like really be implemented by this commission. So to reach out immediately to family members after a shooting without delay and maintain regular and respectful communication with victims' families after each use of force. Ensure that no family member ever again hears from the media or a neighbor that their loved one was killed. Right. 3, ensure that family members have access to see their loved ones at the scene, at the hospital, and are at the coroner's as soon as possible after the incident. 4, demand and support independent investigation into all use of force incidents. Push the state attorney general to appoint a special prosecutor to investigate incidents statewide. Yeah. Demand that the district attorney's office start an immediate and independent investigation and LAPD's MOU with the DA's office, establishing that the office won't begin their investigation until the law enforcement agency involved and completes their investigation.
Right.
Often as much as 1 to 2 years later. Do not block pending an investigation. Family access to victims' compensation funds to help with funeral and burial costs, as well as to free mental health counseling and other victim supports. Immediate these resources for all families. Implement these immediately. Establish a special fund for families to cover additional medical counseling and other expenses. 6, after all use of force resulting in serious injury or death, hold a community meeting within 2 weeks that is open to family members, intervention workers, and or community-based organizations to air community concerns and answer questions. 7, admit and apologize publicly when law enforcement or law enforcement actions are wrong. Make it clear to the community and enforcement with all departments that officers, deputies involved in any actions alleging misconduct or corruption and or resulting in serious injury and death are immediately removed from the field. Community contact pending an investigation and lose all access to the families. If this is not standard procedure, make it procedure. 9, throughout the process, act with humility and do not make any comments that deflect responsibility away from the department, such as officers risk their lives every day or many more people are killed by gang or community violence. 10, work with use of force victims, their families, and community organizations to hold an investigation and hearings on use of force policies and create new policies to strengthen protections for LA communities.
Yeah.
My father.
out of that puppet, Mr. Herman, when you detained him under the TRU service, remember? Yeah, I remember. I remember when I was arrested by a TRU, Brand Management Unit Detective, the one who was under the LLC of Hugo Rossiter, the same gentleman counsel who's paid $300 to $600 an hour for no service whatsoever to you fools. But let's go back to the Baltimore situation. You recall the Baltimore situation where the so-called DOJ of authority stepped in because the Baltimore police were violating the rights of people with mental disabilities? Did you recall that? Look at the docket, fools. Look at the docket, you Uncle Tom, because you can learn something, Johnson. But the people know better. We're not a bunch of bulls. We're a bunch of cattle. Trying to feed off of you. That's why, look at Sobro picking his nose. He's so mad at me. Why do you get so upset, Mr. Bipolar Developer? Did you got your match? I'm full of bullshit? No, I'm just talking my mind with you, fool. So when you do righteous things for the righteous people, we praise you. But when you step into the floor of the general public, Ralph and Brown Act 54954.3, item C says, we have the right as a public to pronounce you fail, H-H-H,
say your name.
Say your name.
Wakisha Wilson.
I went over a lot of things I could say to all y'all in my head, and I couldn't come up with a lot of things. It is barbaric the way that you made her mother come up here and beg y'all to see her child. To see the way her child died. Because none of y'all motherfuckers was up beside the hospital when she was pushing her baby out of her. None of y'all motherfuckers was there. But y'all gonna make her come up here and beg y'all to see her daughter, the daughter that she brought into this fucking world. Y'all gonna make her come up here and beg y'all to see her daughter? Because at the end of the day, the only person that had to pay her for that funeral was her family. Not y'all motherfuckers. But y'all decided to kill her. That's crazy. That's barbaric. I am a black woman. My life matters. Her life, her family life matters, and her community life matters. How the fuck dare y'all sit up here, straight face, to sit up here and make her beg? Fuck that. No. Say her fucking name.
Wakisha Wilson.
Say her name.
Wakisha Wilson.
I'll see y'all again.
Okay, is there anyone else who submitted a card for the name Wakisha Wilson who has not yet spoken?
Okay, thank you. We're now on item number 5, closed session. We have 3 comment cards on 5A1, OIS number 1016. We have Wayne from Encino, Trevor Gerard, and Mr. Herman.
Thank you for starting the clock early. I appreciate it. Oh, there we go. How the fuck can you schedule this with the Wakisha incident? How the fuck can you do that? How can you do that? This is the most important thing this year that you'll ever consider. And you just treat it like it's a schedule item. Another body and another slab for you people. It's unfucking believable. And in this agenda, you go W. Initial Wilson. You can't even put her name on the agenda. A first initial W. Wilson. Why? Because you hope somebody online working their ass off like all of us do, we would just gloss over it and forget it was Wakisha Wilson's incident report. So you got to schedule 2. And then this commissioner here, what, Goldsmith? Can't even fucking stay. Where'd she go? She bailed out. It's not important enough for a commissioner Goldsmith, is it? Give a fuck. It's not even important for her to be here. The most important thing you're going to do this year You're going to decide whether to let murderers walk out of this building without anything or not. The most important decision. And one of you guys, you're down to a quorum of four. Because what are you going to do? Split the tie 2-2? Because I know Steve's going to vote it's within policy. I know Johnson's going to say it's within policy. I know the one at the end over there, I know she's got a heart left somewhere deep in that body. I know she's going to say it's outside policy. I know McLean's going to say it's outside policy. What do you do with a 2-2 tie? Where the fuck is the fifth commissioner? You need to have five on this one, baby. This is bullshit. Really is bullshit.
Of such disgrace, or putting someone's name, a person's name, on your own agenda, first letter initial. What a shame. And what does Madonna have to say for that?
That this march will never add up to anything.
Yeah, we're the marchers. Come here to criticize. They come here to criticize on the policy, the practice, and the procedure of how this department fails to acknowledge someone's loved one. Someone's loved one. My mother is 85 years old, and she can do it all on her own. But there are some of us who have youth, and to see our child die at half the age is ridiculous. So let me read into the record item number 2, ICD-019/16 and number 010/16, the so-called OIS and the ICD, in custody death. How does someone die in the custody of those who serve and protect?
Murder.
Exactly. The same way when I was detained by LAPD and that white fucking cop threw me against the floor and kicked me on the floor while I was handcuffed. Fuck you!
Right.
Don't forget.
We have 24 cards for item 5A2. The first five cards, General Jeff. Michael Novick, Michael Cummings, Sheila Hines, Melina Abdullah, Pastor Hugh Jean Marie, Carl Douglas, Paula Miner, Ingrid Turner, Jamie Garcia,
Good afternoon, Commissioners. My name is General Jeff from Skid Row. So we know that there was wrongdoing in the Wakisha Wilson in custody death. We, the people of Los Angeles, we don't have access to the information of what you all, from investigative reports, from police reports, police testimony, officer testimonies, what video footage, possible body camera footage, and on and on and on. But we know that there was wrongdoing. Look on the agenda, you see four officers. First of all, we know there are more than four officers that work at Metro Detention Centers So we know that it's been narrowed down to these four. So whether these four officers are going to fall on the sword and take one for the team, or they're going to get thrown under the bus and suffer severe consequences. You know, this is a very special moment in time right now because, you know, this matter has been, ever since it was released, we knew that from the very first statement that was released about in custody death by suicide. And we need to see the PIO, the public information officer, also needs to be on this list because the erroneous information, whether the misleading statements, you know, confusing the public, and clearly that shows that there was an in-house panic within the department, and somebody's got to be held accountable for that as well. That involved, that should be included on the list, not only the death itself, but the actions related and surrounding pertaining to the death. So when you say, you know, suicide, you say police corps, I mean a phone corps, well, we know that that's not possible because that was adjusted before Metro Detention Center was even built. So there's a whole lot more, and this is your opportunity as a commission to come forth. We knew in an EZL 4, we called it was going to be tactical errors. We called it a Charlie Kaneng Brother Africa, it was going to be tactical errors. We know there's wrongdoing. We know. There's nothing you can sugarcoat. We just want to know what it is. Thank you.
Here, if it's not a protocol or policy in place, I'm asking for the commissioner to revisit and to put policy and protocol in place as the Wakisha Wilson protocol for our parents and the community and people that's be notified as they in custody so it don't take 3 days. We can probably get it done in a few hours. So I'm asking the commissioner to please relook at that protocol in place. Wakisha Wilson, protocol and policy of how families are notified. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sheila Hines, Brim. No altercation.
Now, when it first, when she first got killed, you guys get your posse together and say, we're going to do this. That came later. It was too late. Because your detectives told the whole story. So let's get the FBI involved. Because you guys are telling the whole story. And your main detective that was on the scene first told the story. And he even went far enough to say, ma'am, I have said too much already.
Wow.
So he said it was an altercation. He said there was a plumbing problem. Uh-oh. He told us all the information. Y'all don't have that?
Wow.
Is that in y'all's report back there? Mm-hmm. Is that missing? Did y'all take that out?
Wow. Uh-oh. Wow.
Thank you.
See, they misinformed you, madam. They ain't telling you the whole story because you are covered. They gonna leave you out. They not gonna tell you the whole deal. They ain't gonna run it down to you like it really is. These, look at these little bastards. You think, just look at him.
Wow.
Look at
what's his name,
Cornell, that's active.
Look
at him.
Thank you for your comments.
No.
Now let us speak.
Should I thank you?
No.
Nope. Should I thank you?
No.
Nope. I'm really not finished. I am very angry today. Because you put my sister again, time after time, when you let these motherfuckers go up here and throw all this bullshit about policies and all this shit. We didn't come here for that. I live in Marina Valley.
Right.
And you think I got grandkids to see about. I got Wakisha's son to see about.
Mm. Wow.
Which, guess what? He's going to be celebrating his mama's birthday on Saturday with us. You guys want to join us at Red Lobster in Inglewood? I'll give you the crackers.
Wow.
Crackers with a cracker message.
That's what you guys can have, the crackers.
And some water.
You eat what you are.
Melina Jula, followed by Pastor Q. Jan Marie and Carl Douglas.
So I don't really know what to say. You could have alleviated a lot of the pain by listening to the request of the family. What was this now? This is 10 months ago that you asked for the video? But instead, you put them through torture. They've been here, you know they've been here every single Tuesday. Every single Tuesday they're here. Her mother and her aunt and other family members are here every single Tuesday saying, we need to know what happened. And even on this day when you're supposed to be going to review what happened, you're still not showing them what happened. You're still saying, trust us, we're gonna go in this back room. And we're going to decide whether or not LAPD is telling the truth about itself.
Right.
Come on. What a lack of humanity. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. And then we, and honestly, you know, some of us have questioned why we still come here. And I don't know. I don't know. I don't know why we come here. It's because we don't, I mean, I don't know what to do. I don't know what else to do. We don't know what else to do. pain and anger, and we don't know how to get justice.
Redistribute the pain.
And we've been told that if you just engage the system, that's democracy. And we know it's a lie, like intellectually, we know it's a lie. We know y'all gonna go back there and then come out after we've sat here. We're gonna have to sit here for like hours. We're not gonna be allowed to have food in the room or even water, right? Then you're gonna come out and say LAPD is telling the truth about itself. We know what the outcome is, but we don't know what else to do. And I think Sister Sheila is right. One day, not too far from this day, we're gonna explode. We're gonna explode in a way that you don't wanna see, that you don't want for your children, no matter how far you live, and you know we know where you live. We're gonna explode, and you have no choice but to do the right thing.
We ain't gonna stop.
You know, we're all ready, but they're going to come back. That's why Carl says, what are you going to do?
Look at the vultures.
That's what we're waiting on. We just pray and just come back with the light.
Thank
you. With the right thing, with the dog, and he just knows that we got to go home.
They don't want to hear us.
So, you know, they're trying to provoke a race war to claim an ISIS so they can put us in concentration. Y'all know, don't you manipulate it. It's going to say we terrorists, but they did to the Jewish people and the Japanese.
So, I'm going to go ahead and stop the live stream. But I'll be in here waiting until they come back. And it probably could take a couple hours, but whenever they come back, I'll come back live.
So what we want to do with this time and space, y'all, like, really, that was what's being shared is we're kind of at a loss now. We know what they're going to decide in there. It's not even a question. We know what they're going to decide. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
We know. We know.
Meeting with millions more people. Take these issues out to the community.
Yeah.
Have the same meeting outside.
So let's have this conversation, recognizing that all this shit is being recorded, right? So let's not make plans here, but let's share ideas here that we know they're honest, right? We can have conversation. That's what I'm saying. Just be cognizant of where we are. And so whatever conversation we have is intentional conversation, right? We're having, and there's some things I want them to hear. I want them to know that it's only going to go so far with us staying in this room and talking to them and pretending like they have a humanity and a spirit and a soul to appeal to. I want them to know that. I don't mind them recording that shit. I don't mind. I said it. You can serve me with a restraining order too.
Right.
How about that shit? I want them to know that. I want them to know that. Right?
If Donald Trump tries to institute stop and frisk, martial law,
it
will lead to civil war.
It's revolution.
It's going to cost. Every time you stop anyone, it's going to cost. It's going to cost them 10 times, 100 times, 1,000 times what they invest in. Everybody. Track each officer participating in. Videotape. Track him. If you're a gangster and you're on parole, get someone else to videotape it. It's going to cost the infrastructure of the United States if they try to institute stop and frisk. Got to do that. Spread that.
LAPD been doing stop and frisk.
Right. If they institute it on the level of martial law, they're doing this. They can stop and kill them.
June last year.
Every stop.
Yeah, that's the beginning of brutalized extermination. That's what they started to do with the Jews and the Japanese, Jewish people first. They started to murder, and then they started to implement the detention centers, and then they did legalized extermination. They're trying to provoke that. They want to say, look, you're terrorists. They want the terrorists 20 years ago.
Don't you care about the town? No more.
So it's a way to go over it.